It is hard to imagine that this quiet stretch of beach was once the scene of some of the fiercest fighting in World War II. This is Omaha Beach, the landing area for the US First Army on June 6, 1944. The memorials to many of those gallant young men who fell on that fateful day still silently mark time. Today, it is monuments like these and the few crumbling relics of Hitler's Atlantic Wall which provide the last visual clues that remain to remind us of the greatest military undertaking of the war. In June 1944, these same beaches resounded to the titanic clash of arms which marked Operation Overlord and the beginning of the end for the Nazi regime in the West. The seeds of victory and freedom were sown here, in Normandy. In September 1939, Adolf Hitler unleashed the modern German armies on the first Blitzkrieg campaign. The power, scale, and strategic brilliance of the armored thrusts quickly brought Poland to her knees. The Polish adventure was followed by an ambitious series of devastating campaigns by land, sea, and air, which led to the capture of most of Europe, North Africa, and Russia during 1940 and 1941. In December 1941, Hitler's allies, the Japanese, took the concept of lightning warfare, copied, adapted, and improved it to become the architects of massive strategic movements, even greater in scope than Hitler's, which rapidly engulfed the Pacific in a new Japanese empire. On December 7, 1941, with a force of 350 aircraft flying from six aircraft carriers, Japan launched an undeclared war against the West. As America reeled under the fury of the surprise attack against its Pacific fleet at Pearl Harbor, reports came flooding in of simultaneous attacks throughout the Pacific. News came of Japanese landings in Malaya and Thailand. The American Central Pacific island of Guam was invaded, and Japanese troops had landed in the new territories of Hong Kong. With her combined force of devastating power and enormous reach, Japan was following in the wake of her German allies. The offensive was on a massive scale. The first truly global war was now underway, and the combined armed force was at its spearhead. From now on, there would be no barriers between war on land, sea, or air. Conflict was total, and the divisions between them blurred into one. In the first 5 months of their war, the Japanese swept through Southeast Asia and the Pacific with a ruthlessness and efficiency that mesmerized their enemies. On Christmas Day, Hong Kong capitulated. By the middle of February, Malaya had been overrun and Singapore was captured. In the Philippines, lightning airstrikes had again caught the Americans off guard. Within weeks, the Americans and their Filipino allies were driven into the Bhutan Peninsula, and from there onto the fortified island of Corregidor, which soon fell in turn. Throughout the length of Southeast Asia, the great European empires had collapsed before the ferocity of the Japanese assault. A new empire had been born. In the Philippines alone, 120 million Filipinos were now subjects of Japan. All of this had been achieved because, for the first time, Japanese sea power was used, not just to transport troops, but as a cohesive unit which, together with air power, combined to form an amphibious assault from land, sea, and air, the like of which had never been seen before. In the dark hours of 1942, the British in particular still had much to learn if the Axis tide was to be rolled back. Their recent experience of seaborne invasions was not altogether good. This is the Bay of Gallipoli, scene of the amphibious landings made by the Allied forces making a surprise seaborne attack on Turkey in World War I. The British, Australian, and New Zealand troops fighting here became locked in a dogged and bloody stalemate which claimed the lives of thousands of Allied troops. The architect of the Gallipoli fiasco was one Winston Churchill, and the lessons learned would prove invaluable when British forces were again called upon to undertake a new form of seaborne invasion. But there was still a long road to travel, and the first glimmer of the possibility of success in the same style amphibious warfare practiced by the Axis came from the American forces in the Pacific. Despite their overwhelming early successes, the Japanese had not broken American naval power. It was severely damaged, but the Pacific Fleet had not been destroyed at Pearl Harbor. The American aircraft carriers escaped damage altogether, and around these a naval task force was assembled, which, in time, would visit destruction upon the Japanese Empire out of all proportion to their own early offenses. In America, the attack on Pearl Harbor had united a divided nation. Isolationism evaporated in universal outrage. An industrial giant had been awoken. Japan could never hope to compete with the rapid production of planes, tanks, and ships. In a little over 3.5 years, the might of America's industry and its immense reserves of materials and manpower would roll back the empire of Hirohito to the very shores of Japan itself. The first taste of that power was seen at Guadalcanal. In the summer of 1942, on the island of Guadalcanal, amongst the southernmost reaches of their territory, the Japanese were building an airstrip from which to mount attacks upon the shipping lanes between Australia and the West. Warned of the airfield's construction, the Allies took the decision to attempt a seaborne invasion of Guadalcanal. Codenamed Operation Watchtower, a task force of 80 ships assembled off the Fiji Islands. On board were the 18,500 troops of the 1st US Marines, troops specially trained in amphibious assault. Steaming northward, bad weather in the Coral Sea hid their approach from the Japanese, and on the morning of August 7th, the fleet's warships began a bombardment of the airfield and the landing zones on the island. As the Japanese retreated westward under a hail of shells, the Marines began wading ashore, but the Japanese responded quickly, sending a force of bombers and fighters south from Rabaul. Alerted to the Japanese approach, Admiral Fletcher ordered his carriers lying off to the south to send up combat patrols to meet them. As fighters wheeled overhead, the task force maneuvered to avoid the Japanese attacks. In the battle for Guadalcanal, the Straits of the Southern Solomons became so littered with the hulls of ships, both Allied and Japanese, that they were nicknamed Iron Bottom Sound. In the first engagement, the Japanese were routed. 3 American ships were damaged, 1 sunk, and 18 aircraft were lost. The Japanese losses were considerably higher. A Japanese battle fleet was dispatched from Rabaul, and Admiral Fletcher, fearing for the safety of his carriers, ordered them out of range. The commander of the task force warships resolved to withdraw at first light. The approaching Japanese fleet, although heavily outnumbered, had already succeeded in dispersing the task force and isolating the Marines on the beachhead. In the waters off Guadalcanal, the American warships weighed anchor, ready to leave in the morning. But the Japanese fleet, sailing southward, was specially trained in the techniques of night fighting. Using star shells, parachute flares, and new high-performance torpedoes, the Japanese inflicted a crushing blow on the task force. By daybreak, two heavy cruisers had gone down, and two more were sinking. A new balance of power had been struck in the Solomons. By day, the Allies would bring supplies to the beachhead, retreating southwards at nightfall. At night, the Japanese brought fresh troops and equipment to reinforce the island, shelling the beachhead before they departed. On the second day, the Marines captured the airfield and the Japanese base, but finding themselves short of supplies and reinforcements, they were unable to move against the remaining Japanese troops, who were, by now, regrouping in the west of the island. After 13 days of heavy fighting, the Marines had completed repairs to the airfield, and a small force of light aircraft, fighters, and dive bombers had been flown in. Throughout August, both sides raced reinforcements to the island. The Japanese with such regularity that their nighttime convoys became known as the Tokyo Express. On September 12th, the Japanese launched their first major offensive on the island. In what was to become known as the Battle of Bloody Ridge, Japanese troops, supported by naval gunfire, launched a night attack against fixed American positions to the southwest of the airfield. Although the Americans were pushed back, the Japanese were unable to capture the airfield, control of which was seen as crucial to the battle for Guadalcanal. It took months of bitter fighting before the Japanese were finally forced to relinquish the island. The remaining Japanese, exhausted or wounded, were evacuated as stealthily as they had arrived. The tide was also turning against Hitler. At the Acadia Conference in Washington, it was decided that the main effort of Allied arms would be first directed not against Japan, but at Germany, the senior Axis partner. Under Operation Bolero, American ground and air forces, their equipment, and supplies were to be shipped to Britain for an invasion of the continent of Europe at the earliest practical opportunity. American planners believed an invasion of France would become a possibility by the autumn of 1942. Military and civilian morale demanded it. With the lessons of Gallipoli still relatively fresh in their minds, the British knew that such course of action could end in disaster. The capabilities of American troops was untested, their experience non-existent. The shipping alone for such an operation would take 2 years to build. In order to satisfy American demands for action and test the abilities of their troops and commanders, a less ambitious operation was planned. The invasion by sea of the Vichy French coast of Africa. Despite the complex diplomatic situation with the Axis powers, America had maintained official contact with the Vichy French regime in Morocco and Algeria. Through these contacts, intelligence had been obtained of beach and coastal defenses, tide and surf conditions, and of the French disposition to fight in what was effectively the Axis cause. Approaches had been made to the French colonial authorities, but unreasonable French demands had made the prospect of French cooperation uncertain. On November 7, 1942, the Allied invasion of North Africa began with seaborne landings near Algiers, Oran, and Casablanca. Fortunately, the only real enemies the Allies encountered were disorganization and confusion. But at Casablanca, these were augmented by fierce resistance from French naval units. As the Allied battle fleet engaged the French force, the confusion on the beaches became critical. By nightfall, more than half the landing craft had been destroyed by broaching and collisions. Only 40% of the troops had been landed, and the smallest fraction of supplies and equipment had been brought ashore. The will of the French fleet at Casablanca was soon broken by Allied sea power. Six French warships were destroyed in the battle, and with them, the French will to resist. In Algiers, with his forces unwilling or unable to fight, Admiral Darlan agreed to an armistice. In the newly captured ports, the unloading of troops and supplies could be resumed. Despite the impatience of the American commanders and the enthusiasm of their troops, it would take more than 6 months to drive the Germans from Africa. On the road to Tunis, crack panzer divisions under Jürgen von Arnim and Erwin Rommel inflicted a series of costly and humiliating defeats upon the inexperienced American troops at Kesserine Pass. Eventually, General Montgomery, arriving from the east, defeated Rommel in a decisive battle near the town of Medina. From the experience of the Allied landings in North Africa, it was clear that more time was needed. Meeting in Casablanca, Churchill and Roosevelt agreed to postpone the invasion of France until the spring of 1944. However, in order to maintain Allied momentum and to relieve the pressure on Russia, an invasion in the Mediterranean was planned for the summer of 1943, beginning with the invasion of Sicily. On July 10, 1943, the invasion was finally launched. In Sicily, 300,000 Italian troops were supported by 50,000 of their German allies. But vital German armored divisions and naval units had been transferred to Sardinia and to Greece by German high command, who had been fooled into believing that the attacks would come there. With the element of surprise in their favor, the Allies quickly established strong positions in the south of the island. But at Gala, the American 7th Army, under General Patton, was counterattacked by a strong German division supported by the giant 56-ton Tiger tanks. It was a critical situation. The Tigers were finally stopped only a mile from the sea when naval gunfire from the battle fleet forced their retreat. As the fighting continued, worrying reports reached Hitler in Germany. Entire garrisons of Italian troops in Sicily had capitulated without a fight, and the Italian navy had still not put to sea. Hitler ordered the transfer to Italy of elite divisions from the Eastern Front, but the transfers were too late to save Sicily, and the Wehrmacht, hopelessly outnumbered and unable to rely on its ally, began a retreat towards the Straits of Messina and the eventual evacuation of the island. The collapse of Sicily, coupled with the unwillingness of the Italian forces to engage the enemy, led to anger and recrimination in Rome. On July 25th, Mussolini was dismissed from power and arrested, and a new government under Marshal Badoglio was formed. With the prospect of invasion imminent, Marshal Badoglio began secret negotiations that would lead to his country's unconditional surrender to the Allies. With German reinforcements pouring into northern Italy, the Allies knew an Italian surrender could provoke a German coup. Marshal Badaglio warned them of this possibility and requested an invasion to the north of Rome. But Rome was then out of range of Allied air cover, and the area of Salerno, just south of Naples, was selected as the next point for the invasion of Europe. The Adriatic coast was as peaceful in 1943 as it is today. But in 1943, it was a deceptive air of peace. The Italian surrender was broadcast on September 8th as the invasion fleet was underway. On board, some of the anxieties and fears of the assault troops were dispelled in a wave of euphoria and relief. Now there would be only one enemy to fight. With the element of surprise in their favor and the prospect of little Italian resistance, no preliminary bombardment of the beaches was carried out. But in Italy, the Germans had already taken over, and at Salerno, they were ready and prepared. From out of the sky, enemy fighters and bombers screamed down on the invaders. Panzer formations surged forward across the plain. In reply, the Allied naval batteries erupted into life. In the crossfire, the transports raced men and equipment to the beaches. And gradually, by sheer weight of numbers, the beachheads were established. The German commander in Italy, Field Marshal Kesselring, was convinced he could push the invaders back into the sea. He rushed reinforcements to Salerno from all over Italy, and by September 12th, over 600 tanks and mobile guns had been assembled for a major attack against the precarious Allied lines. For 3 days, the Germans pressed the weight of their attack against the Americans at the mouth of the Seal River. Troops and armor rolled westwards down the river valley, pushing the Americans back to within 2 miles of the beach. The Luftwaffe, aware of the crucial role being played by the naval guns, shifted its attack from the beachhead to the ships. Radio-controlled glide bombs appeared out of nowhere, released from high-altitude German bombers. As the warships and transports weaved in the water below, fighters vied for control in the air. On the beachhead, fear and exhaustion sapped morale. General Clark, fearing the worst, drew up plans for an evacuation. But on the third day, the warships finally halted the German advance. With mounting losses in men and armor, Kesselring ordered a withdrawal and began a fighting retreat northwards to fortified positions between Naples and Rome. The Germans, in spite of being outnumbered by almost 3-1, had inflicted heavy losses on the Allies, and thousands of prisoners had been taken. Reports of the fighting at Salerno again spoke of the inexperienced American troops. Though they had been driven back by overwhelming force, the Wehrmacht rightly considered their actions at Salerno to have been a success. It reaffirmed their determination to fight for every foot of Italy. On October 1st, the Allies entered Naples, only 100 miles from Rome. But the terrain and the weather now favored the German defenders. Throughout October and November, Kesselring fought slowly northward while he prepared his defenses at the Gustav Line. In December, as winter set in, the Allies reached Kesselring's line of defense at the town of Cassino. Above the town, guarding the Liri Valley and the road to Rome, stood the ancient abbey of Monte Cassino. a monstrous fortress and the pivot of the German defenses in Italy. Fought to a standstill, the Allies knew it would take supreme efforts to break through the German lines before the spring. On Churchill's initiative, a daring operation was planned to break the deadlock in Italy. Confident this would not be a repeat of the Gallipoli debacle, he urged that a strong and mobile force be landed at the town of Anzio, between Cassino and Rome. By striking quickly to the Alban Hills, the road and rail links to the south could be taken and supplies to the Gustav Line cut off. A major surprise assault on the rear of their lines would surely have a great chance of success, as the German forces in Italy were already stretched desperately thin. On the 17th of January, the offensive was launched. It began with a traditional frontal assault. Allied troops attacked along the length of the Gustav Line with the secondary objective of drawing German reserves in the rear away from the region of Anzio. In this respect, they were entirely successful. On the 22nd, after a long detour by sea, the invasion force arrived at Anzio. On the first day, nearly 40,000 troops, with their supplies and equipment, were landed in one of the smoothest operations of the war. A rapid push towards the Alban Hills would have been largely unopposed, but General Clark had rewritten the original operation orders and advised caution to General Lucas at Anzio. It was 4 days before Lucas ventured forth from his beachhead positions. Kesselring, caught by surprise, reacted quickly. Rushing a skeleton force to the area to act as observers, he called for reinforcements. Not from his beleaguered forces in the south, but from the north and west, from as far as France and Yugoslavia. Within days, Kesselring had 40,000 men in the area. Within a week, he had 6 divisions of some 120,000 men. They were supported by the latest tanks and artillery. Together they advanced towards the beachhead, pushing the Allies back to shorter and shorter lines. To add to the maelstrom, a giant railway gun, firing 560-pound shells over 40 miles, bombarded the beachhead. Holding the interior position, the Germans were able to reinforce their attack along shorter lines of communication. And meter by meter, in some of the bloodiest fighting of the war, they drove the Allies back into a narrow salient around the town. Echoes of Gallipoli must have sounded in the mind of Winston Churchill. But at Anzio, as at Salerno, the German drive was checked at the last moment by massive naval gunfire and by air support, which the beleaguered Germans no longer possessed the means to counter. Although the German advance had been stemmed at Anzio, the force that Churchill had unleashed had become stranded. There were 3 more months of bitter attrition before the beachhead was finally relieved by Allied troops from the south. It was clear that the preparations for the planned invasion of Europe would need to be made on a much greater scale. To give more time, the promised invasion was delayed until 1944. It would become the largest undertaking ever mounted in military history. This time, it had to succeed. Experience in Sicily and at Salerno had shown the need for overwhelming weight of arms, and to ensure success in the coming invasion, vast arsenals of equipment were being amassed. General Eisenhower was appointed commander of what was to be the greatest Allied operation of this or any other war. In October 1943, Field Marshal von Rundstedt convinced Hitler that an invasion in the West in the spring had become inevitable. From now on, he argued, the drain of men and equipment from the German forces in France must cease. To prepare for this decisive engagement of the Allied and German armies, Hitler ordered Rommel to conduct an inspection of the Atlantic coastal defenses. He demanded that every beach from Denmark to Brittany must be made impassable. Using impressed French labor, a line of impregnable fortifications was built. This was Hitler's Atlantic Wall. Even today, more than 50 years later, the sad remains, built at a great cost of blood and human misery, still linger on the peaceful beaches of Normandy. Thousands of new pillboxes for anti-tank and infantry guns were to be constructed by April at the latest. But von Rundstedt knew that the task was too great for the time allowed. The Atlantic coast was too long to be effectively buttressed against a determined invader, and many of their defenses existed only on paper. To engage the Allied warships offshore and to maul the flotillas of transports and troopships, naval guns were housed in indestructible bunkers. Behind the line, tracks were laid for railway guns, many capable of firing huge shells as far as England. The experiences of Salerno and Anzio had convinced von Rundstedt that armored formations could not be driven against the beachheads themselves, and that the decisive battle must be fought inland and out of range of the massive guns of the Allied fleet. The mobile and armored divisions, he insisted, must be held in a central reserve, a panzer army to be known as Panzer Group West. But Rommel, the master tactician of Blitzkrieg, had grave doubts about Rundstedt's strategy. Having suffered defeat at the hands of the Desert Air Force in Africa, and having seen his panzers routed, he knew that without air support, there could be no mobile war for the Wehrmacht in France. He knew that the promise of thousands of new jet fighters could not be kept. Rommel argued that the armored divisions must be held close to the coast. The decisive battle for France could only be fought at the water's edge. To appease both field marshals, Hitler ordered a compromise, which had the benefits of neither plan and the shortcomings of both. Rommel was to command only three panzer divisions. Three were to be deployed in southwest France. The remaining four, including three elite SS divisions, were to be placed under von Rundstedt in Panzer Group West, but committed only on Hitler's personal orders. By this fateful decision, the Germans lost the few tactical advantages they held. Under the transportation plan agreed by Eisenhower and his air chiefs, the main weight of the bombing offensive was to be shifted from Germany to the Low Countries in France. Unlike Italy, the terrain in the west allowed rapid deployment of men between fronts. Rail, road, and canal networks were extensive and efficient. The objective of the transportation plan was the total destruction of the communication systems in France. To win supremacy in the air for the Allies, the Luftwaffe in France was attacked in an unremitting and remorseless campaign. By 1944, the Luftwaffe was technically outclassed as well as hopelessly outnumbered. It was simply overwhelmed. By May, Rommel's worst fears were brutally realized. The Luftwaffe was virtually wiped out in the West. Since the autumn of 1940, British agents had been infiltrating the lands under Axis occupation. Resistance networks had been established, and from them came much of the intelligence necessary for Allied planning. intelligence such as details of troop strengths and concentrations, and of fortifications and defenses. Throughout France and the local countries, the networks were briefed. An invasion of France was to be expected sometime in the coming year. Coded messages broadcast by the BBC would give the time, but not the place, of the attack. Arms and explosives were flown in. A campaign of sabotage was to be mounted. The transportation plan was to be pursued on the ground as well as from the air. By May, the French railway system was in ruins, and every bridge over the Seine between Paris and the sea was destroyed. In Britain, a major campaign of deception was mounted. It was designed to convince the Germans that the attack would come further north, in the Pas-de-Calais area. On the east coast of Britain, as far north as the Firth of Forth, a mock army was assembled. Its equipment largely constructed out of canvas, rubber, and wood. Transmitters were erected to simulate the radio transmissions of the 15 non-existent divisions, which were destined, the Germans believed, for Pas-de-Calais. To complete the deception, aerial reconnaissance was far greater over that area than over any other sector of the front. Allied planners already knew the attack was to be made on the beaches of Normandy to the west. Codenamed Operation Overlord, the invasion of Normandy was scheduled for June 5th. From all over southern England, the convoys of men and materials, fuel and equipment began to make their way to the ports of the south coast. By the evening of June 3rd, the great embarkation was complete. But on the 4th, the weather forecasters predicted a heavy channel storm. High winds, low clouds, and heavy seas combined in the target area on the 5th. Air support was impossible, landing of troops hazardous, and in the heaving seas, naval gunfire would be very inaccurate. Eisenhower agreed to a postponement of 24 hours. No further postponement would be possible. If the Armada did not sail on the 6th, it would not be able to sail for at least another fortnight. Ships at sea would have to return to port for refueling, and not until the 20th would the tides again be favorable. Men would need to be disembarked, and morale would suffer. Above all, the element of surprise was likely to be lost. But the forecasters predicted a slight break in the weather for the morning of the 6th. The weather window was not expected to last for more than 24 hours. It was just enough. Eisenhower took the decision to go. In ports all over southern England, the great Armada weighed anchor and began to move out into the channel. Warships and convoys, marking time at sea, converged to join it. During the night, 5,000 ships crossed to an assembly point just off the French coast. The Germans could not detect its approach, their radar system having been all but destroyed by tactical airstrikes. In France, messages broadcast to the French resistance alerting the networks of the coming invasion were intercepted by the Germans, and the powerful 15th Army guarding the Pas-de-Calais was put on alert. But no one warned the 7th Army guarding Normandy, and no one warned Rommel, who had only just left for Germany to ask Hitler for reinforcements to bolster the dangerously weak Normandy sector. As dawn approached, the first phase of the great invasion began. Three full airborne divisions began a series of landings by glider and by parachute in the Bocage countryside of Normandy. Their task was to seize vital centers of communication in the rear of the German lines, to disrupt reinforcement and resupply of the Atlantic Wall defenses, to hold essential bridges and causeways for an Allied advance. At dawn, the naval bombardment began. From airfields in southern England and from carriers lying offshore, wave after wave of airstrikes were launched in an onslaught of unprecedented fury. Steaming shoreward, landing craft unleashed barrages of rockets. Behind them, seasick and anxious, came the men who would secure the beaches for the following waves of troops, and for the sapper teams who would clear the beaches of mines and obstacles. This is Omaha Beach, where the American First Army was to land. Further along the coast was Utah Beach. To the east, the British and Canadians were to establish lodgements at Gold, Juno, and Sword beaches. At Utah, the beach defenses were quickly overcome. But here at Omaha, the Americans met fierce resistance from first-line German troops, manning the most formidable fortifications that the Allies would assault throughout the entire course of the war. The battle for Omaha quickly became a battle between the warships and the guns of the Atlantic Wall. In the British sector, the landings were much easier. Inferior troops manning weaker fortifications were quickly overwhelmed. Armor and equipment was brought ashore, and the advance inland began. From his home in Germany, Rommel ordered his deputy to mount a counterattack against the British positions to the north of Caen. This is Caen today. Only a very few traces of the events of 1944 remain, as mute monuments to the ferocity of the fighting which all but destroyed the town. As the British pressure increased, Rommel asked von Rundstedt for the immediate deployment of Panzer Group West, but the power to commit these divisions was not von Rundstedt's. They could be released only on Hitler's orders. It was late afternoon before Hitler agreed to the release of Panzer Group West. At Omaha, after bitter fighting and many casualties, the beachhead was finally secure. With advance units pressing nearly 2 miles inland, fresh troops and equipment could be brought ashore. By the end of the first day, more than 150,000 men were landed by sea and by air, and with them, thousands of tanks, guns, and vehicles of all kinds. Although the invasion forces were well short of their targets for that day, the beachheads had been established, and when Rommel returned to France, he knew that the war was already over for Germany. By the end of the second day, less than 70 German fighters were operational in France, while thousands of Allied fighters and bombers scoured the west, disrupting reinforcements and supplies with their incessant aerial bombardments. This is a surviving fighter bomber, now housed in the Imperial War Museum, still proudly displaying the famous D-Day markings of black and white stripes on the wings. Facing an ever-expanding Allied beachhead, Rommel asked for mobile divisions from the 15th Army from the Pas-de-Calais to be transferred to the Normandy sector, but Hitler was still convinced that the invasion of Normandy was merely a feint to draw troops away from the Pas-de-Calais where the main invasion would take place. The 15th Army, he insisted, must remain in defensive positions. By the 12th, the Allied lodgements in Normandy had joined into one continuous beachhead and artificial harbors were being constructed. On the 16th, the Americans began a drive across the Murderet River and the Continent Peninsula to isolate the port of Cherbourg to the west. To the east, Montgomery mounted a further attack towards Caen. A breakthrough at Caen would have led to the plains of central France and a rapid drive towards Paris. But Rommel had chosen to make his stand at Caen, and elements of six panzer divisions had been assembled there. The British were thrown back with heavy losses, but the defence of the city had drawn the bulk of German reserves and armour to the area. Now rebuilt and peaceful, the city is as prosperous as many in France. In 1944, it was a hell on earth. On the 10th of July, Caen finally fell to the British, and with it any prospect of a decisive victory for the Wehrmacht in the west. With the city in Allied hands, an eastern sector of the beachhead was now secure. Holding the superior position, the British continued to pin down German armour and reserves. A major Allied offensive was now planned. On the 18th of July, the Allies captured the town of St. Lo and began a drive to the south. Breaking quickly into open country, armored divisions under General Patton overran the stretched German defenses and seized the town of Avranches, the gateway to Brittany and the south of France. Hitler, against all the advice of his commanders, ordered a counterattack against the flank of the Allied advance. Using divisions withdrawn from the region of Caen, the attack was launched through the town of Falaise. With the German lines of containment now reduced, Montgomery was at last able to break out from Caen. In danger of being cut off and captured, and attacked continuously from the air, the Germans began a retreat towards the Seine. But the encirclement was quickly completed. 50,000 German troops were left behind, and with them most of the equipment of 10 German divisions. Within a month, the Allies entered Paris. Within a year, Berlin. As Rommel had predicted, without air support, no German counterattack could prevail. Once the beachhead had been established, overwhelming Allied air and naval power had ensured it remained. The battle for France had indeed been decided at the water's edge. In the long and grisly battle for Guadalcanal, the failure of the Japanese Navy ensured the ascendancy of American sea power in the Pacific. Against the vast resources of American industry, the Japanese could never hope to compete. The capture of Guadalcanal itself provided the first step in a series of seaborne conquests throughout the islands of the Pacific to the home waters of Japan herself. The fierce Japanese resistance on Guadalcanal had come as a shock to the Americans, the withdrawal a relief. But there were to be very few tactical withdrawals by the Japanese. In their advance through the islands, the Americans found that Japanese tenacity and will to resist became stronger the closer they got to Japan. On the island of Saipan, in the Marianas, 30,000 Japanese troops lost their lives rather than surrender. 8,000 Japanese civilians, clutching their children, threw themselves from cliffs into the sea. At Leyte Gulf, in the Philippines, with the aid of the kamikaze pilots, the remnants of the Japanese Navy struck for one last time. Suffering horrendous losses in ships and men, the sea power of Japan was finally broken. The ability to protect her home waters ended. On Iwo Jima, the Americans found a fanatical enemy manning extensive fortifications. Through February and March 1945, 7,000 Americans were killed fighting on Iwo Jima. and of more than 20,000 Japanese defenders, only 216 were captured alive. On Easter Sunday, 1945, the Americans landed on Okinawa, in what was to become known as history's greatest madhouse. Nearly 150,000 Japanese soldiers lost their lives. Swarms of kamikaze pilots swept down on the invasion fleet in a last vain bid to save the island. During the battle, nearly 1,500 kamikaze attacks were made on the fleet, with only very minor success. It became clear that an invasion of Japan would result in an appalling loss of life too great for Allied planners to countenance. To break the will of Japan and to demonstrate the hopelessness of her situation, another means of ending the war was tried. On August 6th at Hiroshima, a city died. A new and terrible era of mass destruction had dawned.